Welcome to Drawing from the Well, the preaching ministry of Rehoboth Baptist Church with Senior Pastor Alan Stewart. We trust you'll be blessed and find faith, hope, and comfort as we draw from the principles and promises of the Word of God together.
Thank you. Well, good evening. It's good to see you all here on a cloudy but still a beautiful evening. Let's all stand and sing some praises to the Lord this evening. Heaven came down. Down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole, my sins were washed away, and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. I've a hope that will surely endure after the passing of time. I have a future in heaven for sure, there in those mansions sublime. And it's because of that wonderful day when at the cross I believe. Riches eternal and blessings supernal from His precious hand I receive. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul. When at the cross the Savior made me whole, my sins were washed away, and my night was turned to day. Heaven came down and glory filled my soul.
Amen. You can be seated this evening. Good to see each of you here. And you know, there is a verse as Moses was stepping off the scene. I've been preaching some out of the book of Deuteronomy on Sunday mornings. But Moses let the people of God know that God wants to give you a little taste of heaven right here on earth. Now, the question is, we live in a sinful world, a broken world. There is sorrow, there is sadness, there is separation. All of these things happen here on earth. So where do we get that little taste of heaven? It's even in the midst of those kind of moments, God supplies joy, a peace, a grace, a goodness. He supplies glory to us, even in the midst of the most trying times of life. And in those times, God gives us just a little taste of what it's like in heaven. Amen. Great to see you here tonight. Let's pray and ask God's blessing. Lord Jesus, we come to You so thankful You meet every need of our life moment by moment. There is a grace that is always available to us for whatever we're dealing with and whatever we're facing. And I pray tonight in this place that there is a grace that is available to everyone. May You, O God, speak to our hearts out of the Word of God and help us to learn a spiritual discipline that is rarely talked about, but is most desperately needed, not only in the church, but also in our personal lives. So I pray You'd use this very simple message tonight. And Father, I bring all the brokenness of who I am before You and just ask You to speak through me tonight to encourage hearts, give wisdom, maybe some enlightenment somewhere that there's questions and concerns about life. But Lord, be pleased to meet with us tonight. God, we're going to be disappointed if we leave this place and we haven't got intimately into Your presence. And I ask it all in Jesus' wonderful, precious, glorious name. Amen.
Amen. As we stand together again, let's lift our voices in praise again. Are you washed in the blood? Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood? Sweet and low, fear not, I am with thee, peace be still, in all of life's ebb and flow. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Discord filled my heart with pain. Jesus swept across the broken strings, stirred the slumbering chords. keeps me singing as I go. Soon he's coming back to welcome me far beyond the starry sky. I shall wing my flight to worlds unknown. I shall reign with him on high. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. My Jesus, I love thee, I know thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin I resign. My grace, Savior, art thou. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I love thee because thou hast first loved my pardon on Calvary's tree. I love thee for wearing the thorns on thy brow. If Jesus, 'tis now. In mansions of glory and endless delight, I'll ever adore thee in heaven so bright. I'll sing with the glittering crown on my brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now.
All right, you can be seated. As you're being seated, would you take your Bible and find the Old Testament book of 1 Kings. 1 Kings chapter number 3 tonight. And again, I want us to deal with the subject of a spiritual discipline that is so desperately needed, but is so desperately lacking, not only in the church, but in our personal lives. And it is a very difficult discipline to develop. But it can be done. And all we have to do is learn God's secrets of how to do it. 1 Kings chapter 3. You may know this story well. Let's begin in verse number 5. In Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night. And God said, "Ask what I shall give thee." And Solomon said, "Thou hast showed unto thy servant David, my father, great mercy, according as he walked before thee in truth and in righteousness, and in uprightness of heart with thee. And thou hast kept for him this great kindness, that thou hast given him a son to sit on his throne, as it is this day. And now, O Lord, thou hast made thy servant king instead of David my father. And I am but a little child." He's saying, I'm a young man, inexperienced, unseasoned. I know not how to go out or to come in. And thy servant is in the midst of thy people, which thou hast chosen, a great people, that cannot be numbered nor counted for multitude. Now he answers the question. Give therefore thy servant an understanding heart to judge thy people, that I may discern between good and bad. For who is able to judge this, thy so great a people? And the speech pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this thing. Animal sentinels are commonly used to detect risk to humans by providing advance warnings of some impending danger. Take, for example, in the early days of the coal mines, they didn't have the feature of ventilation systems. But canaries are especially sensitive to methane and carbon monoxide. And so the miners would bring them along in cages so that they could put them in the coal mining scene. The birds' rapid breathing rate, the small size, and their high metabolism made them ideal for detecting dangerous gas buildups. As long as the birds kept singing, the miners knew that their air supply was safe. But when the canary stopped singing, or worse, died, then the miners knew it was time for an immediate evacuation. By virtue of their heightened sensitivity to danger, the birds served as a safety feature of discernment for the miners. Winston Churchill said this, "The great thing is to get the true picture, whatever it is." For all of us, life is full of so many choices. And sometimes choosing one thing over the rest throughout your life, you'll find that it can be a dangerous and a very difficult thing to make that choice. What all of us need in our life is a sentinel, something that can detect a danger and alert us before it's too late. With that thought in your mind, I want to speak to you tonight on the subject, secrets of discernment. Now in this passage of Scripture, we're told God appears to Solomon in a dream. And he asked him this question, "Ask what I shall give thee." That is, it's an open-ended question. God has handed him a blank check. "Solomon, tell me what you want." Now, have you ever thought about this? As he asked this question, Solomon could have asked for a long, healthy life. Or he could have asked God for a mighty army that would defeat all the enemies of his kingdom. He could have asked God for riches so that his life would have been easy and quite secure. But Solomon recognizes he's got some youthful inexperience about life. And so he gives the answer in verse 9, "Give therefore thy servant an understanding heart." God, give me wisdom, is what he says. But then he tells us why he needs the wisdom. "So that I can judge thy people, that I may discern between good and bad." Now the question tonight is this, what is discernment? Well, discernment is the ability to make honest judgment. That is, to make careful and cautious distinction between different shades of gray in your life. Now, the simplest definition I could probably give tonight, it is the ability to decide between truth and error, between light and darkness, between right and wrong, between that which is primary and that which is secondary, that which is essential and that which is optional, or better yet, that separates between the good, the better, and even the best. Paul put it like this in Philippians 1, beginning in verse 9, "And this I pray, that your love may abound yet more and more in knowledge and in all judgment." The word judgment means discernment. "That ye may approve things that are excellent." You know, ours is a society that prides itself on brilliance and creativity. High levels of education have given us some incredible medical breakthroughs, even in our lifetime. It's given us some unimaginable technological advancement. However, in our pursuit of education and information, we are losing sharp, accurate discernment. I love this verse in 1 Chronicles 12 and verse 32. And the children of Issachar, which were men that had understanding, it means discernment, of the times to know what Israel ought to do. Now the great dilemma in our generation is not what is doing what is right as much as it is knowing what is right. The need for spiritual discernment among God's people has probably been never greater than it is today in our world. But sad to say, in most churches and most Christians' life, discernment is in long demand, but it's in very short supply. I like what Jean de La Bruyère, a 17th century French essayist, said. He said, after a spirit of discernment, the next rarest things in the world are diamonds and pearls. That is, discernment is a very rare thing to find. But yet in the Scripture, in the Word of God, we are commanded to cultivate a life of spiritual discernment. So, what are the secrets of cultivating and developing discernment? Three things I want you to think with me tonight about. First of all, accurate discernment demands a consistent exposure to light. Again there in verse number 9, give therefore thy servant an understanding heart to judge thy people, that I may discern between good and bad. Now first of all here, Solomon is requesting the wisdom from God to know how to discern good from bad. And there are three meanings that I want to pull out of that verse for the points tonight. And the first meaning and idea between separating and discerning the good and bad, he's talking about separating between that which is pleasing and that which is displeasing to God. Now, ladies and gentlemen, the only way that you will ever learn what is pleasing and displeasing to God is to know His Word. Listen to what the psalmist said in 119 in verse 66. Teach me good judgment. Again, it means discernment. And knowledge. Why? For I have believed thy commandments. Now listen, for you to have good spiritual discernment, there's got to be a standard, some kind of criterion in your life that helps you to separate and to know what's pleasing and displeasing. And do you know what that standard is in your life and mine that should test everything in our life? It is God's Word. Those who live applying biblical truth and principles every day in their walk are people who do not live on hunches, feelings, suspicions, and guesswork. God does not want us living with those kind of feelings and thoughts and emotions. He gives us a standard that we know right from wrong. I love what Charles Spurgeon said. Listen to this. Discernment is not a matter of simply telling the difference between right and wrong. Rather, it is the telling the difference between right and almost right. That's powerful. The psalmist again said this in Psalm 119 and 105. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet. He provides light so that there can be discernment. You can see clearly, make good judgments, and it is a light unto my path. Now listen, the longer we stay in the light of truth, the clearer and more instinctive God's perspective is on a matter in our life. You know, scuba divers often go down to depths where the darkness is so thick they cannot see their hand right in front of their face. The darkness can be very disorienting to them, and to combat their fears and panic, the divers are taught when they're learning to do this to feel from the bubbles of their regulator. The bubbles can always be trusted because they will only go in one direction, and that is upward. And using that as an illustration tonight, the Word of God and the truth of God, it only goes in one direction as well, and that is the right direction. God leads us in the right direction through His Word. So first of all, I want you to think about on this. You must appreciate the Word of God. Psalm 119, listen to verse 16. I will delight myself in thy statutes, and I will not forget thy word. That is, you must simply have a love of the Word of God if you want to have good, clear, accurate discernment. The life blessed by God can never be separated from reading and studying God's Word. One of the greatest sins of our age is our neglect of God's Word. And that is why that we have so many weak and ineffective, immature Christians in our churches, because they don't have a love for the Word of God. Now listen, God speaks to our lives first and foremost right out of His Word. Within this Word is revealed to us the heart, the mind, and the character of God, which enables our lives to develop spiritual instincts of right and wrong. To love God is to love His Word. And to love His Word is to be a powerful Christian. I heard a story about a preacher who came to visit a woman who had been visiting the church. And she was trying to show off a little bit to the pastor as he came and sat in the living room. And it was time that the Scriptures were going to be read before they prayed. And so she looks over to her son and she says, "Go get that book that mother loves so well." The little boy ran out of the room and he came back in the living room carrying a JCPenney's catalog. Now listen, we've got to love the Word of God. Let me tell you something else the psalmist said about the Word of God in Psalm 19, beginning in verse 7. "The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, yea, than much fine gold. Sweeter also than honey and the honeycomb." May God make us like Thomas a Kempis, who often said these words, "I have no rest but in a nook with the book." So we must appreciate the Word, but secondly, you must assimilate the Word. The psalmist said in Psalm 1 in verse 2, "But His delight is in the law of the Lord, and in His law doth He meditate day and night." Now, it's one thing for you to appreciate the Bible for its literary excellence and its theological concepts, but it's quite another thing to go deeper into the message of the Bible. You know, the art of meditation is as needful to our spiritual health as strength as chewing food and digesting it is to our physical. Now, I've told you in other messages somewhere down through the years that this word meditate is a picture of a cow who is chewing his cud. Now, the question tonight is, what does that mean to us? We don't sit down and chew cud. At least I hope and pray you don't here in Saudi Daisy. Some of you might do that. But listen, what do we do to chew the cud spiritually? Two things. First of all, you pray over it. You ever thought about this? Listen in Psalm 119 in verse 135. He says, "Make thy face to shine upon thy servant," and here it is, "and teach me thy statutes." Have you ever prayed that kind of prayer? "Lord God, I'm about to open your word. Would you simply be my teacher?" And then listen to this prayer in Psalm 119 and verse 18. He says, "Open thou mine eyes, that I may behold wondrous things out of thy law." Now here's the truth tonight. There are spiritual scales over your eyes until God takes the scales off when you read this book. Now physically, you may have 20/20 vision, but God has to open your eyes before you can behold wondrous treasures that are found inside of His Word. So how do you meditate, chew the cud, and you pray over it, first of all. But then secondly, you just simply ponder it. Again in Psalm 119 and verse 148, he says, "Mine eyes prevent the night watches that I might meditate in thy word." You see, it takes time. After you've prayed over a passage of Scripture, then you ponder it. And as you ponder it, you simply expect God to reveal something to you. I want to give you an illustration out of my own quiet time here just in the last week of how this works. There's a passage of Scripture I've preached several times through the years and I've studied. I know almost every detail I would think in my mind about this story of Abraham ready to offer his son Isaac. I know the details of that story, how he turns around in the moment that he's ready to offer his son, and there caught in a thicket by his horns, the word says, is a ram. God provided a sacrifice to take the place of his son. Now, as I'm praying and I'm meditating and thinking about this story that I've known so well, I've preached it, I've heard it since I was a child, there was then something new and fresh in the meditation God revealed to my heart that I'd never caught. And here it is. As you think about this poor old ram who's caught in a thicket, how sad, how tragic, how misfortunate it is for that ram to be caught in this scenario. But his misfortune became another's fortune and blessing. That's how it works, ladies and gentlemen. You take a story and a passage of Scripture, you pray over it, then you think and you meditate, and God allows things to come right up to your heart, and here's what He does. He feeds your soul. I love what Jeremiah said, and he was so right about this concept in chapter 15 and verse 16. He says, "Thy words were found, and I did eat them. And thy word was unto me the joy and rejoicing of my heart." So you must assimilate the word and appreciate the word. But thirdly, you must appropriate now the word. Psalm 119 and verse 35, he says, "Make me to go." That is, let me travel. "Put my feet in the path of thy commandments, for therein do I delight." Now it's one thing for you to pray for God to show you something, and it's another thing when God does. But once He does, now you have a responsibility and an obligation, and here it is. It is to be obedient, to live it out every day in your life. Let me ask you tonight, do you really want to learn more about the Word of God? Then here's a secret. Begin to obey the parts that you do know. It sounds so simple, but listen, the Bible says, "To him that hath, shall he be given." Now you may say tonight, "But listen, Pastor, there's an awful lot of Bible that I just don't understand." Now you know what? Can I be transparent with you tonight? I've been a pastor here for 21 years in ministry, 36 in preaching. There's still a lot of Bible I don't understand. But I love what Mark Twain said. I want you to listen to this. He said, "It's not the part of the Bible I don't understand that gives me so much trouble. It's the parts that I do understand." You see, not only must you learn it, God expects you to live it. And you've never really learned it until you are living it. Put the Word of God in your mind. Put the Word of God in your mouth. Put the Word of God in your manner of life. And you then will discover that night and day it will have meaning, it will have relevance, it will have significance in every situation that you are trying to discern in your life. Number two tonight. Accurate discernment depends upon a clear evidence of leading. Again in verse 9, "Give therefore thy servant an understanding heart to judge thy people, that I may discern between good and bad." Now again, here in Solomon's request for wisdom to discern that which is good and bad, here's the second idea of that phrase, good and bad. It means discerning and separating that which is acceptable from that which is unacceptable. Paul said it like this in 1 Corinthians 2 and verse 14, "But the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him, neither can he know them, now listen, because they are spiritually discerned. Now, you know, we love to divide people up in categories. For example, we say that they're in the upper class, middle class, and lower class. But in the Bible, here's how God divides us. He divides us from the natural man, the carnal man, and the spiritual man. The natural man just simply does those things that are natural. The carnal man does those things that are unnatural. But the spiritual man does the things that are supernatural. How do you get there? Two things. First of all, you must learn from the Spirit. Again, he says that these things are spiritually discerned. In 1 Corinthians 2, again, listen, beginning in verse 9, "But as it is written, I have not seen nor ear heard, neither have entered in the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love Him. But God hath revealed them unto us by His Spirit. For the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God." Now, the natural man, with all of his education, brilliance, and wisdom, and all of his philosophical ideas, he can only see things. But the wisdom of the Spirit enables us, listen to this, to see through things. That is discernment. Think about this tonight, how it's used in our physical sense. Medical doctors, they go to school for years. They are trained to recognize many outward symptoms. But do you know that there are sometimes things where doctors are limited? They can't see inside of our bodies with their natural physical eyes. And so do you know what a doctor does to gain that discernment? He orders maybe an x-ray, a CT scan, maybe an MRI. And what that enables them to do is to see through your body so that they're able to get a clear, definite diagnosis. Listen, if Isaac had not trusted in his intuition alone, he would have seen through the camouflaged hands and recognized it's the voice of my other son, Jacob. If Joshua had not trusted in his intellect alone, he would have seen through the disguise of weary travelers and recognized it was his enemies, the Gibeonites. You know, when life presents us with deep mysteries, only God has the knowledge of those things that lie beneath the surface. You see, the spiritual man knows things that can never be taught in school. You learn from the Spirit, but then you live by the Spirit. 1 Corinthians 2 and verse 12, "Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit which is of God, that we might know the things to discern that are freely given to us of God." Now a spiritual man is someone who has received the Spirit of God. That is, he's been saved. He's been born from above. He's been invaded by the Holy Spirit. And then the Holy Spirit then guides us through a manner of a witness of inner peace. We're told this in Romans 8 and verse 14, "For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God." Now, how does He lead us in our lives? Jesus said it like this in John 16 and verse 13, "And when He, the Spirit of truth, is come, He will guide you into all truth." Understand this, when you are filled with the Word of God and you're filled with the witness of the Holy Spirit of God and you're trying to discern something, He will never, hear me loud and clear, He will never lead you in contradiction to the revealed Word of God. It is that peaceful assurance that He gives to our heart when we're discerning. It gives us confidence and courage to move forward even when we might be facing insurmountable odds. Those unsettled warnings that He's been giving, they are then replaced with an unusual peace. This is what you need to do. There's a third thing I want you to see, and finally tonight. Accurate discernment draws from the collected experiences in life. Again, in verse 9, "Give therefore thy servant an understanding heart to judge thy people, that I may discern between good and bad." Now, the third meaning and idea of discerning between good and bad is learning how to separate that which is valuable and that which is worthless. 1 Corinthians 2, listen to verse 15. "But he that is spiritual judgeth all things, yet he himself is judged of no man." Now, what does that mean when he says judgeth all things? Does that mean that like somehow you and I are going to be in a courtroom and we get to make all these big judgments and decisions? No, listen. He's talking about inward discernment. The word judge here means to discern, and he's using it as a legal term. He's describing here like a lawyer who examines all the evidence, and then he builds his case, and then he makes certain judgments. Hebrews 5, listen to verse 14. The writer is noting a mark of spiritual maturity is those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. It's a sign of maturity when you can discern that which is acceptable and unacceptable, pleasing and unpleasing, and between that which is valuable and that which is worthless. I'm sure every parent has had this experience when your children were just still little toddlers. Children don't have a whole lot of discernment. Number one, they'll run right across a four-lane highway, never think to look twice. Have you ever noticed this about little children? If you set them down on the floor when they're a toddler in a restaurant or in a mall or some shopping place, you set them on the floor for just a moment and look at something on a shelf, when you turn around, they'll pick up a cockroach and put it in their mouth. They'll pick up a used cigarette butt, they'll just stick it right in their mouth. They have very little discernment. When I was 3 years of age, I overheard my father mentioning to some of my uncles that he wanted to go fishing. I had a pure motive in my heart as a three-year-old child. I just wanted to be helpful. I'd mentioned too him that I knew where some really big worms were in my grandmother's garden. So I go down in her garden with one of her ball jars, and I come back with about 10 big worms. Nobody was any more surprised than I was to learn that those were not big worms, they were baby garden snakes. I didn't have any discernment at age 3. Listen to me though. Today I know the difference between big worms and garden snakes. You see, those who are sharp in their perception have lived life with their eyes wide open. And they have been learning valuable lessons along the way of their journey. Now here's a spiritual truth tonight. The farther we go in our walk with the Lord, every one of us ought to be progressing from weakness to wonder to wisdom. 1 John 4, listen to 2 verses. Number 1, "Beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God. Believe, because many false prophets are gone out in the world." In verse 6, "Hereby know we the spirit of truth and the spirit of error." Listen, it is critical for us to be able to discern the spirit of truth and of error. The spiritual man discerns all things. And here's why. He's got a different set of values. He sees things through a different set of lenses in his eyes. Left to his own logic and reasoning, man, the natural man and the carnal man, will always go with what feels right and what looks best on paper. In Matthew 16, the religious leaders asked Jesus for a sign, and he answered their request in verse 3. You can discern the face of the sky, but you cannot discern the signs of the times. Here's what Jesus was saying to them. You're spiritual leaders. You're older men. You ought to have matured by now in life. And the things that you should have seen most obvious were the things that you absolutely missed. Can I tell you what the clear sign you're walking in the Spirit is in your life? We've all learned this the hard way. When you are not walking in the Spirit, the Spirit convicts you after you've made your judgment and decision. That's what He does. He convicts us. But when you're walking in the Spirit, He gives you that unsettled heart. He gives you the warning bells before you would make that decision. Before He gives you discernment so that you don't have stupid moments in life. Let me ask you tonight, anybody in here got any stupid moments in your life? Anybody got some things you wish if you had it to do over again, you would have discerned better? You would have stopped and prayed over, you would have pondered before you stepped and made the decision. And it was wrong. And you were convicted. There would have been conviction on the other side. That's the wrong thing. Listen, discernment is not as much about spotting a sign as it is developing the ability to see with the eyes of God. The decisions of life then are never more confidently made than we have the knowledge of God's full perspective before we decide. Let me close with this story tonight. Lucas Compton of the New Yorker magazine tells a story many years ago when the floor at the Princeton College gym was being resurfaced. And so Princeton's most famous basketball player, who would later become a United States Senator, Bill Bradley, had to go over to a Lawrenceville school in order to practice. When he walked into the gym at Lawrenceville, he began shooting 14-foot jump shots from the right side. Those of you that knew Bill Bradley, the NBA player, you know he was a phenomenal basketball player. But on this day, he gets off to a bad start. He keeps shooting and shooting and missing and missing. Six in a row hit the back of the rim and bounced off. Bill had never had this to happen. So he stopped and paused. He was a little frustrated, but he seemed to be making some kind of adjustment in his mind, this author said. Then he went up for another shot from the very same spot, and he hits it cleanly. Four more shots in a row, and all of them went in without a miss. Then Bill pauses, and he turns to this writer, and here's what he said. You want to know something? That basket is about an inch and a half low. That's why I've been missing the shots. Several weeks later, this writer went back to that gym just out of curiosity. He took a measuring tape, he borrowed a stepladder, and he measured from the floor to the rim of the basket. He discovered it was 9 feet, 10 7/8 inches above the floor, or about 1 1/8 inches too low. I played a lot of basketball in my life. I don't know that I've ever had the perception that the rim might be an inch and a half, a little low. But you see, there was a sharpness in his heart to perceive that. And the whole point of that illustration is this. God can give us the perception of the most minuscule difference in a decision of that which is pleasing, displeasing. between that which is acceptable and that which is unacceptable, between that which is valuable and that which is worthless. And ladies and gentlemen, sometimes the line is so close. May God teach us the discipline and the secrets of discernment. Heads bowed and eyes closed, they come with a song of invitation tonight. Maybe tonight there are decisions and circumstances in your life and you need discernment. A natural man and a carnal man will do what feels right. He'll do that which looks best on paper. But a spiritual man discerns all things with the eyes of God. If you're about to make some decision in your life and there is some step and you don't know, wait. Wait until the Spirit of God speaks out of the Word of God to your heart, and then with the peace of God that He gives in your mind, and then you just go do it confidently. Again, the spiritual man judges and discerns all things. Would you come tonight? Holy Spirit of God, I pray that every man, woman, boy, and girl that's listening tonight would come out of this place with a little sharper discernment. And if they don't possess it, may they leave here tonight with a little understanding of how to get it. God, it is in great demand, but in short supply. May You help all of us tonight as we throw ourselves at Your mercy. Give us discernment. In Jesus' name, amen. As we stand and sing, would you come tonight?
Take up Thy cross and follow me. I gave my life to ransom Thee, surrender Your all today. Wherever He leads, I'll go.
God bless you. Thank you for being here tonight, and I pray God will give you sharp, clear, accurate discernment for the decisions and steps of life that you're going to make from here to Sunday. May God give us His eyes. God bless you. Thank you for being here tonight. It's been good to be in God's house. Larry, I'm going to let you close us out, brother.
Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Let's lift that up together. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Have a wonderful evening. We'll see you back here on Sunday.